So our first talk is from Karma Mori, the infective lifetime of quasar population redshift 6. So please go ahead.
Can you all see this?
Yes.
Hi, thank you. My name is Karna Morai, and I'm a third year undergrad at MIT. And today I'll be talking about estimating the lifetime of the quasar population at redshift 6 via their stacked proximity zone. this work was done in collaboration with Christina Eilers, Fred Davies, Joe Hanawi, and Rob Simcoe. So first of all, the main motivation for this work is understanding more about supermassive black holes. And supermassive black holes occupy the centers of all known massive galaxies. And the study of the formation and evolution of these black holes is an ongoing area of work. So these black holes grow primarily via accretion. One ways in which we can study this process are via quasars, which are extremely luminous objects caused by matter accretion onto black holes. And these quasars, especially at high redshift, are an extremely powerful laboratory for understanding supermassive black hole growth in the early universe. Under the exponential model of a black hole growth, a black hole grows exponentially in the initial seed mass according to this Salpeter timescale, which under standard assumptions is assumed to be around, or is known to be around 45 megayears, assuming 10% radiative efficiency and Eddington limited accretion. And so this means that for a 100 solar mass population 3 stellar remnant, this means that the quasar would need around 10 to the 9 years to actually grow into a 10 to the 9 solar mass black hole. But the problem is that where we observe plenty of these quasars, the universe is less than 10 to the 9 years, so years old. So really, to actually understand this growth, there's a lot of unanswered questions. So I'm focused in this talk on understanding this quasar lifetime TQ, which is the duration of the luminous quasar phase. And the reason is that if we understand this lifetime, we can really start to constrain and answer more questions about different parameters about this growth process, such as the initial black hole seeds or the accretion rate. And so recently, some of my collaborators pioneered the use of proximity zones to determine the lifetime. And quasar proximity zones are the region around the quasars where the quasar's ionizing radiation has ionized the neutral IgM, therefore there's enhanced flux bluewards of Lyman alpha. And the size of this proximity zone is related to the lifetime of the quasar. So the amount of ionization increases as the quasar gets older. And you can really see this in this animation. So as the lifetime TQ increases, you can see that there's more transmitted flux bluewards of Lyman alpha. And so really, this is a very powerful tool because if we can measure the proximity zones of these quasars, we can just directly infer the lifetime. And so in this work, we stack 15 quasars at redshift 6 and compare their stacked proximity zones to radiative transfer models, which are shown in this plot here. And so we can compare the stacked proximity zones directly to these models and measure the lifetime of the quasar. And so we have 15 quasars in our sample between redshift 5.5 and 6.5, and we only select quasars with an AB magnitude at 1450 angstroms between -26.5 and -27.5. And the reason is that the size of the proximity zone not only depends on the age of the quasar or the lifetime of the quasar, but also on the luminosity. And so to not bias the sample, we we make sure that they're all within this range. These spectra were taken using X-Shooter, DMOS, FHIR, and ESI instruments. And so here are the 15 spectra. And so basically we, here are the spectra shown, and then also we performed continuum normalization or continuum fits on both the red and the blue side using the 2018 Davies method, the PCA-based method. These are a little bit hard to see, so I zoomed in on J0842. So you can see we fit between 1220 angstroms and 28 angstroms in the rest frame on the red side, and then we can use the Davies projection matrices to get the blue side continuum. And then we can use this later for continuum normalization. And so the analysis roadmap is we first continuum normalize all the 15 quasar spectra using our continuum fits. We then stack the quasar continua via a binning algorithm. And then to understand the uncertainty on these quasar stacks, we forward model the noise, the different sources of uncertainty in our analysis using the radiative transfer models. We can Monte Carlo sample each of the sources of uncertainty and forward model them onto these models to understand what the uncertainty is and to get covariance matrices. And then we can compare the models to the stack by performing a final fit with our modeled covariance matrices and basically estimate the lifetime directly. And so here's step one, continuum normalization. We just divide the spectra by the continuum, pretty standard. And then step two is stacking the 15 quasar spectra via binning. And so we just take an average of all the flux pixels within a particular wavelength bin. And for our final analysis, we chose 0.5 angstrom bin size. And so the third step is trying to quantify the noise on the stack. And so the way we do this is forward modeling the noise. And so the radiative transfer models give a different model for each value of the lifetime. So we have a grid of 80 different lifetimes. And so for each value of the lifetime, for each value of TQ on our grid, we can we can create mock stacks of thousands of different mock stacks of these quasars, where we, for each mock stack on each of the different quasars, we sample different sources of uncertainty, such as cosmic variance, PCA continuum uncertainty, redshift uncertainty, and spectral noise. And so we just Monte Carlo sample each of these based on the parameters of those particular quasars. And we can then create thousands of mock stacks and then take the covariance of all these mock stacks, the wavelength bins. And so here's a plot of the correlation matrix. And you can see it's mostly diagonal, although there is some correlation between close bins. And so finally, we can use these covariance matrices, and we obtain one for each value of TQ. And we can use these covariance matrices to directly inference the lifetime. And so the value that we get here is the posterior distribution. The median lifetime is 10 to the 5.7, and shown here are the 68 and 95% confidence intervals. And so here's also a plot of the comparison between the data and the models. So in purple is the model or the mean model from all the mock stacks, along with the one sigma uncertainty on it, which is basically the diagonal of the covariance. And so you can see it fits the data fairly well. And so this is basically a measurement of the effective lifetime of these 15 quasars at Z equals 6 or redshift 6. But it's an effective lifetime because really in our analysis, we're assuming that all the quasars have the exact same lifetime. In our mock stacks, we kind of stack all only quasars of the same lifetime. And so this is obviously not true in reality. These quasars come from the lifetimes come from a distribution. And so we kind of wanted to get a sense of what the how introducing a spread around a mean value for the quasar lifetime distribution would change it. And so in our mock stacks, we kind of introduced the forward modeling process allows you to introduce a distribution. So instead of in our mock stacks all having quasars of the same lifetime, we had quasars of different lifetimes drawn about some distribution. And so here are shown the mean models along with the one sigma uncertainty for different widths about the same mean. So we're all using the same mean model, TQ of 5.10 to the 5.7, but different widths. And you can see that there's not really any change until you get like around sigma of 2. And most previous work suggests that this width is probably around 1 or less, maybe 0.7. And so really within our method, we can't really distinguish the two. And so this kind of suggests that this effective lifetime 10 to the 5.7 is actually very close to the mean. And so in conclusion, we conclude that the effective lifetime of these quasars at redshift 6 is 10 to the 5.7, which is very consistent with previous studies done by Christina and Ilya Kurgan. And this is more than a magnitude shorter than what was previously understood. Recall at the beginning of the talk, I said about 10 to the 9 years. And so this, or 10 to the 8 years. And so this suggests that this possibly suggests that there's a radiatively inefficient, aka super Eddington accretion in these high redshift quasars, or a significant population of obscured, UV obscured quasars at redshift 6. So for future work, we want to investigate these mechanisms and actually understand exactly what is in this discrepancy. And so thank you very much for listening, and I'll be happy to take any questions.
Thank you very much. This is really a beautiful talk. Thank you. We have some time for questions. So Tom asked, nice, does the relative transfer model include DLAs, which could be what limits the extent of the near zones rather than the lifetime of the quasar?
Can you repeat the question?
Does the model include damped Lyapunov systems, which could affect how the near zone or the proximate zone extend rather than a lifetime of the quasar itself?
I am not exactly sure about that, but I can get back to you on the Slack about that.
Does Christina or Fred know the answer?
The model, so we exclude any proximate DLAs or any any absorption systems that would truncate the proximity zone. We exclude them from the spectra itself. And so they should not be taken into account and not prematurely truncate the proximity zone. But the models themselves do not include any dense gas.
Thank you. Any other? I have a quick question. When you say the dispersion of your quasar lifetime is 0.1 or 1 or 2, I assume these are basically assuming log normal distribution of their lifetime?
Yes.
And these are log scale? Okay.
Yeah, log normal. Like all of them are with a mean of 10 to the 0.5, 10 to the 5.7, or a mean of 5.7 in log space, and then sigma of 0, 1, or 2 in log space.
Okay, just one more quick question from Sarah. The average lifetime constraints presumably only applies to the last UV bright phase. What is the recombination timescale of the gas?
I'm also not quite sure about that. Christina, do you know that?
Yeah, so generally, yes. So the lifetime constraints only the UV bright phase, because that's only the part that gets you the proximity zone. the recombination time scale within the proximity zone is actually fairly small. So the hydrogen recombination time scale is large back to neutral, but within the proximity zone, you only have to recombine to very small neutral gas fraction to be opaque to Lyman alpha. So this does not take any flickering, if that's your actual question, this does not take any flickering quasar light curves into account.
Great. All right. There are more questions on Slack, so you can continue that discussion there. And thanks again for your really nice talk.